Good morning, Twickenham. Let's worship together. And I said, it's all right.
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 It's all right. It's all right.
It's
Don't
all
you
right.
know that it
just a little talk with Jesus makes it right?
Don't you believe it's all right?
It's all right.
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 It's all right. Don't
all right.
you know that it
just a little talk with Jesus makes it right?
I once was lost in sin.
I once was lost in sin. Jesus took me in,
and then a little light
from heaven filled my soul.
It bathed my heart
it
in love,
and wrote my name above,
and just a little talk
with Jesus made me whole.
Because I said it's all right,
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 it's all right.
It's all right. Don't
it's all
you know
right.
that?
Just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Just a talk with Jesus.
It's all right.
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 Don't
it's all
you know
right.
that
it's just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
I may have doubts and
I may fears. Have doubts
my
and
eyes be filled with
my
tears.
Eyes be filled with tears.
But Jesus
But Jesus is a friend
who watches day and night.
I go to him in prayer.
He knows my every care.
And just a little talk,
just a little talk
with Jesus makes it right.
And I said, it's all right.
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 It's all right. Don't
all
you know
right.
that
it's just a little talk with Jesus makes it right?
Don't you believe it's all right?
It's all right.
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 It's all right. All right. Don't
all
you
right.
know that it
just a little talk with Jesus makes it right?
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry.
He will
answer by and by.
If you
feel a little prayerful yearning
as your
heart into heaven is turning,
you will
find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
It's all 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 right. Don't you know that
just a little talk with Jesus makes it right?
Just a talk with Jesus.
It's all right.
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 Don't you know that
just a little talk with Jesus makes it right?
I never know when to come to that song. Hey, good morning. Welcome. Glad you're here. And I got here a lot earlier than I should have, so I'm glad you're there. I hope you're tuned in just fine. We've been telling you for months now that it's going to be all right, and we're singing about it, and it is. It's getting better, and we've announced it, but I'm going to talk a little bit later about when we're going to come back together as a church. We have a date, and I'm excited about it. And it is going to be all right. Here's one of the things that we've learned through this whole experience, and that is that our God is faithful. Even when we are not here, or you can't be in whatever church you attend, God is there. God is here for us. He is faithful always. That's going to be an underlying theme of this service and of a series that we're launching today. So I'm glad you're with us. Jump right in. Sing with us. Worship with us. We got a great communion thought coming a little bit later on. I'm glad you're here. Thanks for joining us.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King.
His love endures forever.
For he is good, he is above all things.
His love endures forever.
Sing praise, sing praise.
With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever,
and for the life that's been reborn,
His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. To the setting sun, His love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever and ever, forever.
His love endures forever, His love endures forever, His love endures forever, His love endures forever. Sing praise.
Proverbs 3:3-6. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to Him, and He will make your path straight.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace, never once did we ever walk alone? Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own.
are faithful. God, you are faithful.
Every step
we are breathing in your grace. Evermore we'll be breathing out your praise. You are faithful. God, you are faithful. You are faithful. God, you are faithful. Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us.
More like you,
Jesus, more like you.
Oh,
fill my heart with your desire to make me more like you, Jesus, more like you. Jesus, more like you.
Oh,
touch my lips with holy fire and make me more like you. Lord, you are my mercy. Lord, you are my grace and all my deepest sins have forever been erased. Draw me in your presence. Lead me in your ways. I long to bring Jesus, more like you.
Oh,
fill my heart with your desire to make me more like you. Jesus, more like you. Jesus, more like you.
Oh,
touch my lips with holy fire and make me more like you. Touch my lips with holy fire and make me more like you.
We've come to that time in our service that we typically call communion. The Greek word it is derived from also means community or society. This observance has changed quite a bit over the centuries. From what we know about the first century believers in Corinth, it seems that the Lord's Supper was a pause during a fellowship meal for thoughts to be centered on the miracle that brought them together, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. One scriptural reference for this sacrament is Acts 20 and verse 7. On the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Paul spoke to the people, and because he intended to leave the next day, kept on talking until midnight. Did you notice what it said, aside from the fact that the sermon lasted till midnight? First, they came together. Second, they came together for the purpose of sharing this meal. Why was it important for God's people to come together then? And is it just as important now? This group of countercultural believers needed to stick together. They were called to look very different from the world, and so are we. This morning, it is impossible for us to all come together. So let's remember that even though we are separated in body, we are one in Jesus. We are many, yet we are one. As you partake of the supper, whether you're watching live or later, I want to encourage you to think of someone who needs to have their spirits lifted. Think of someone who has mentored you in your walk of faith. Think of someone you would typically hug on a Sunday morning. Maybe you need to think of someone with whom you are at odds. Is your disagreement more important than your relationship? Reach out and begin a conversation. Here's what I want you to do. During this communion, think of the unity Jesus prayed for in the days leading to the cross and send a text message to someone with a unifying word of encouragement as we participate together in the body and blood of our Redeemer. Don't wait. Do it right after this prayer. We need each other.
Let's pray. God, we do share this unity together through the great sacrifice that you made for us in the death of your Son, Jesus. And we offer thanks for his body. And we offer thanks that it in itself and only it unifies us together with you. And we offer our thanks as we take it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to
God, we do thank you for the amazing grace that you've shown us. We who are not worthy are made righteous through the blood of Jesus. And we offer our thanks for that as we take it together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Turn my heart, O Lord, like rivers of water. Turn my heart, O Lord, by your hand, till my whole life flows the river of your Spirit, and my name brings honor to the Lamb. Lord, I surrender to your work in me. I rest my life by your hand.
satisfy my soul like you. Who on earth could comfort me and love me like you do? Who could ever be more faithful, true? I will trust in you. I will trust in you, my God. There is a fountain. Who is the King? Victorious warrior and Lord of everything. My rock, my shelter, my very own. Blessed Redeemer who reigns upon the throne. My rock, my shelter, my very own. Blessed Redeemer who reigns upon the throne. Who can satisfy my soul like you? Who on earth could comfort me and love me like you do? Who could ever be more faithful, true? I will trust in you. I will trust in you, my God. There is a fountain. Who is the King? Victorious warrior and Lord of everything. My rock, my shelter, my very own. Blessed Redeemer who reigns upon the throne. My rock, my shelter, my very own. Blessed Redeemer who reigns upon the throne.
Right there's where we would have applauded really big if you were all here. We'd have a big round of applause for the Lord there. So, couple of announcements before we get into the message this morning. First one, we have a date in mind. Now, this past week, Governor Ivey, or as we like to call her, Governor Meemaw, relaxed even more standards circumstances so that more and more people could come together. And so that's a good sign. We're watching the numbers carefully, but we are targeting Sunday, June 7th for our first time to come back together in months. And so you put that on your calendar. We're going to be watching the news and the numbers very carefully. Right now, that's our plan. But now look, what we want to do is do the very best we can to love our community, to love our neighbors. And if coming back together is the best way to do that, then we'll be together on June 7th. If it's better, if it's more loving to not come together, then that's what we're going to do. So we need you to pray for wisdom and know that the leadership here is watching the numbers very carefully. We're listening to our local and state leaders about their guidance on all of this. But right now, that's our plan. So we're going to keep that. We'll keep communicating that to you in a lot of different ways. We'll use all the media we have available to us. It'll be on Facebook. It'll be Twitter. It'll be on our website. You'll get emails, phone calls, and we may even send you a letter. I don't know. But there's going to be a lot of different ways we get in touch with you to let you know kind of how things are going. There will be a lot more information about what that day will look like. Probably it's going to be two services, one at 8:30 and one at 10 o'clock. Probably we're going to ask you to register so we'll know how many people to plan for, and there will be all kind of sanitation procedures before, during, and after. We're going to let you know all of those very specific and detailed plans in an excruciatingly long email and other ways. So just pay attention, okay? Keep it in your prayers. Second thing, we have nominated, you guys, all of us together, have nominated three new additional elders, James Miller, Mike Thomason, and Clark Anderson, and you should have gotten an email about that this week, okay? If you didn't, then you need to contact Steve Krieger. You reach Steve at Steve, S-T-E-V-E, at twickenham.org, Steve at T-W-I-C-K-E-N-H-A-M.org, Steve at twickenham.org, if you didn't get an email with the link so that you can confirm or not those new guys and reconfirm or not all our existing elders. I can tell you they're all great guys. You should confirm them. But if you didn't get that email, Steve Krieger is the guy you need to talk to. Steve@twickenham.org. And if you're not a member at Twickenham, you don't get to vote. I'm sorry. I'm just so sorry. So you should come to church here all the time. All right? Okay, so we're starting a new series this morning. I'll tell you about that in just a second. I'm going to tell a story that I'm almost certain I've told here before. But I'm going to tell it again for a lot of different reasons. Number one, it's true. Now, not every preacher's story is a true story. They all have truth in them, but they're not all true stories. This one's got truth and is true. It really happened. And I'm going to tell it exactly as it happened. The second reason I'm going to tell it, even if I've told it before, is because we have a lot of new members who wouldn't have heard it. And then third, we got a lot of people listening online who wouldn't have heard it. And then fourth, we have a lot of you who heard it, but you don't remember half of what I say anyway. So there we go. So here's the story. This happened literally decades ago. It was at our first church, and I was working on a sermon. And you know when you have to do kind of mind work, thinking work, you need a lot of focused time. You can't do like 10 minutes and then step away and then come back and do 10 minutes. You got to have a lot of time, right? So I kept getting interrupted. I'm working on this sermon. I don't remember what it was about. I know it was going to be like the greatest sermon ever, but I couldn't get focused on it because the phone kept ringing and people kept coming by and the church secretary kept coming in and asking me stuff. And so finally I just said, look, I'm going home. Lisa was at work. We didn't have kids yet. So I told my assistant, I said, I'm going to go home and I'm going to focus on this. Don't call me. So I go home. I got all my junk spread out on the kitchen table. And for an hour, I'm like into this text. And it's just, boy, the Lord has given me insights. And it's really cooking, man. It's so cooking. And then I looked up, and I'm sure I must have been musing some really profound thought. I looked up, and I looked out the kitchen window, and I see this guy walking up my driveway. And I'm going, great. I get away from all the interruptions, and what happens? I get an interruption. This guy comes walking up, and as soon as I saw him, I knew what he was. He was a book salesman. And so I thought, okay, I'll just pretend I'm not here. I won't go to the door. But then he looked in the window, and he was like, hey. And I'm like, hey. So he knocks on the door, and I think, all right, at this point, it's lying if I don't go to the door. So I go to the door, and he starts into his sales pitch, and I just put my hands up, and I said, stop, don't even, okay? I did this when I was in college. I sold books when I was in college, and I know what you're going to say. I probably have the books that are in your bookcase. I don't need those books. I don't want those books. And I know that you're not going to believe me. I know that they've told you that the first no means I need more information, and the second no means maybe, and the third no means yes. And until I say no like five times, you're not going to believe me. So let's practice. No, 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 no. I'm not buying a book from you today. And then you would have thought I'd kick the guy's dog. He was like, almost cried. And then I felt real convicted, and I said, okay, look, I'm not going to buy a book, but why don't you come in? You can sit down. I'll give you a glass of tea. And he went, thank you. So he came in. He sat down. I put a glass of tea down in front of him, and I said, I'm not buying a book from you today. And he went, okay. And I asked one question. I was just trying to be polite. Just one question. That's all it was. Where are you from? And I'm just trying to be nice, right? Well, for the next 20 minutes, this guy just kind of throws up his emotions all over the table. I mean, they're just everywhere, and he misses home, and he misses his mom and dad, and people have been mean, and people act like they're not home when they really are home, and I know it. And so I felt bad about him for him. I felt bad about him, too, now that I think about it. And then finally, I thought, okay, this is an opportunity. It's not going to be hard to turn this conversation toward God. So I said, do you go to church anywhere? And he went, no, not really. I said, do you believe in God? And he said, oh, yeah, I believe in God. So we started talking about that. And before long, I'm like showing him scriptures and asking him if he wants to be baptized. And he thinks about it for a minute, and he goes, I don't think I'm ready for that because that's really outside my faith tradition, but you really raised some good questions, and I'm going to think about them, but I got to tell you, you've really been nice to me, and that means a lot. And then he left. And then 6 weeks later, he came back to deliver the books that I'd bought from him, okay? So, look, anything for Jesus, right? Okay? And I will never forget this. He said, I'm still not ready to be baptized, but I got to tell you, I keep on thinking about it, because those scriptures you showed me and those questions you asked me, That kind of gave me something to think about. I have no idea what happened to that guy. No idea whatsoever. I tell that story because I bet you've got something like it in your life. Somebody, something that interrupted your life, and it turns out that the interruption that you dreaded and tried to avoid and wanted to get away from was really probably a pretty good thing, right? But not all interruptions are. We're right now in the middle of this giant interruption. The virus has interrupted just about, it's a monstrous interruption. It's a worldwide interruption. It's a pandemic level interruption, right? I mean, family vacations, travel plans, your work, school, church attendance, your finances, everything has been interrupted and disrupted. Depending on who you believe, the global economic impact in 2020 could be up to $4 trillion. And it's not just global business, it's our business, it's our finances that have been interrupted, our work that's been interrupted, right? I mean, this past week, the Space and Rocket Center laid off, the museum there, they laid off like 100 people, a third of their staff. So this is hitting a lot of us on a very personal kind of level. Interruptions wreak havoc on our plans, on our routines, on our schedules. And so instead of avoiding it, we're just going to kind of lean into it in this series. The series is titled Interrupted. That's when God things happen. And so what I hope we can find is that it's in the interruptions where God changes us. And God challenges us, and God uses those very interruptions to reshape us, to make us better people, better sons and daughters of God. So we're going to look at stories in this series of people whose lives were radically interrupted by God, and how those disruptions radically blessed them. The first one, though, and this one's in Genesis chapter 18, so if you want to flip over to that on your device or in your hard copy Bible, Genesis chapter 18. This first one's got a little bit of a twist to it, okay? It's not your average divine interruption. I'm going to read the first 16 verses, so here we go. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up, and he saw three men standing nearby. And when he saw them, he hurried from the entrance to his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and then you can all wash your feet and rest under the tree. Let me get something to eat so that you can be refreshed and then go on your way now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered, "do as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. "Quick," he said, "get three seahs of the finest flour and knead it and bake some bread." Then he ran to the herd and selected a choice tender calf and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set before them. And while they ate, he stood near them under a tree. "Where is your wife, Sarah?" they asked. "There in the tent," he said. And then one of them said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now Sarah was at the entrance to the tent, which was behind him. Abraham and Sarah were already very old, and Sarah was past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, "After I am worn out and my Lord is old, am I to have this pleasure?" And then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Will I really have a child now that I'm old? Now that I'm old, is anything too hard for the Lord?'" Which, by the way, is a really good question. When you're in a tough spot, it's good to ask that question. Is anything too hard for the Lord? "I will return to you at the appointed time next year, and Sarah will have a son." Sarah was afraid, so she lied, which is what we do, and said, "I did not laugh." And the Lord said, "Yeah, you did." When the men got up to leave, they looked down towards Sodom, and Abraham walked along with them to see them on their way. Okay, so if you're a churchgoer, that's really a pretty familiar story to you. I mean, you've heard it before, right? You probably did the flannel board Sunday school lesson thing with it. Maybe you saw puppets acted out, right? But if you're not a churchgoer, or these days a church viewer, this is brand new to you. And I honestly, I kind of envy you. because you're seeing this story for the first time. You're seeing it with fresh eyes, and I wish all of us could experience this story in a new and fresh kind of way. So in order to try to make that happen, to see this in a new way with fresh eyes, let's ask some questions. And here's the first one. Who interrupted whom in this story? Who is the interrupted and who is the interrupter? If you'd walked up to Abraham, he's sitting there in front of his tent. If you'd walked to him and said, hey, excuse me, but I don't mean to interrupt, but can I ask you a question? Abraham would have been like, you're not interrupting. I'm not doing anything. I'm just sitting here in front of my tent trying to cool off and trying to recover from the circumcision that you read about in chapter 17, but I'm not doing anything. See, Abraham, he's not doing anything to be interrupted. He looks up and he sees three travelers walking down the road that he assumes are just regular, ordinary guys, and he goes and interrupts them. He stops their journey. They're walking by. He stops them. Abraham is the interrupter, not the interrupted. So here's another question. Who are these three guys? That's been the subject of some debate, and I don't mean arguing, but people have just, they've debated this one. They've wondered about it. They've agreed and disagreed and kind of walked all the way around it. Who are these three guys? Here's what we can know for sure. They are not your ordinary, average, everyday, run-of-the-mill strangers. They know things strangers shouldn't know. They know Sarah's name. They know that Abraham and Sarah have been given a promise. They know that that promise involves a child. They know when the child is going to be born. They know that the child is going to be a boy even before Abraham and Sarah have the big reveal party where they spray everybody with blue confetti. The other thing that we know about these guys is that at least two of them are angels. We learn that in the next chapter, Genesis 19. That's what we know for sure. Everything else now is speculation. Some people say that this trio is made up of God the Father and two angels. Some say it's God the Son and two angels. Some say that it's God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit, the Trinity, right? And Christians have been arguing about this since the second century. We've been trying to figure this out since then, but if the Jewish rabbis have been arguing about it for even longer than that, because this story is way older than Christianity. Some rabbis say that it's Yahweh, God, and two angels. None of them say it's the Trinity. None of them say it's God the Son. But some rabbis claim that the three strangers are just three angels, that God's not involved in that trio. That's just three angels. And to me, that one is the most intriguing conjecture. Here's why. Because if that's correct, and it may not be, okay, but we're trying to see this with fresh eyes. If that's correct, then here's what happened. Go back and look at verse 1 again. Seriously, go back, look at it again, read it. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance to his tent in the heat of the day. So here's what you've got. You've got God and Abraham in front of Abraham's tent. That's scene 1. God and Abraham having a conversation in front of the tent. Scene 1, verse 2. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance to his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. So here's what some rabbis say happened. Some of the Jewish teachers say this. They say that God and Abraham were having this conversation. When Abraham looks up and sees three guys coming, and he says, basically, hey, God, hang on a second. Do you mind if I go show hospitality to these three strangers that are passing by my tent here? And God goes, sure, I'll wait. So Abraham basically, if that's the way it happened, Abraham interrupts his conversation with God. He puts God on hold. Can you imagine that? God, hang on a second, click. Puts God on hold so that he can go show hospitality to these three guys. He feeds them. He gives them water. He walks with them a little ways, which is a feature of Near Eastern hospitality. You would walk with people a little piece on their journey as if to say, I'm reluctant for you to go. It's why people in the South walk with you out to the car in the driveway when you're leaving, and they kind of carry on another 30-minute conversation out there. It's their way of saying, we don't want you to go. Abraham does all of that, and then he comes back to his conversation with God. And so the rabbis who interpret that passage this way conclude that showing hospitality to a stranger is as important as encountering the divine presence. In other words, if that's what happened, God was willing to have his conversation with Abraham interrupted for the sake of caring for another human being. Which could remind you, and it turns out that human being was an angel, that could remind you of a passage in the New Testament, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2. Show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without even knowing it. Or as one of the older versions put it, they have entertained angels unaware. Regardless of where you land in your interpretation of that passage, whatever you think happened, a couple of things are clear. God is willing to be interrupted. God is interruptible. Whether God is one of the three strangers, Abraham interrupts his journey, or whether God and Abraham are having a conversation and Abraham puts him on hold to go tend to these guys over here, God is willing to be interrupted. Have you ever had this experience where you go talk to somebody, maybe she's really important or she thinks she is, and the gatekeeper stops you and says, she can't see you right now. You'll have to make an appointment or you'll have to wait. Have you ever had that experience? You won't ever have that experience with God. You can walk up to God and you can say, hey, God, look, I know you are super busy. You're like sovereign of the universe. You got a lot. You're keeping all the planets spinning. Everything's, I know you got a lot going on your plate, but do you have just a second? God will never say to you, make an appointment. God will never say to you, sorry, not right now. Now's not a good time. God will say to you every time you interrupt him, yeah, I got all the time in the world. Man, a day to me is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years is like a day. What's on your mind? When our boys became teenagers, we got them cell phones because we always wanted them to be able to get in touch with us. And I had this policy that if I was in a meeting and one of my kids called, whatever was going on in that meeting, I was going to say, I got to take this call. It's one of my kids. Now, look, I am nowhere near perfect. And there have been seasons in my life when I was nowhere near good. But I always took a call from my kids. If I, being a sinner, would take a call from one of my boys, don't you think your God is going to take a call from you every time? He will always be willing to be interrupted. We call it prayer. That's really all prayer is. Interrupting God and telling him what's on your heart and what's on your mind. I'll tell you where we see that most clearly. We see that feature of God's personality most clearly in Jesus. There are so many stories in the Gospels where Jesus is on his way to one place, and then he is interrupted by human need, and he goes to a different place. He's got one agenda, and then somebody with a need interrupts him, and they become his agenda. Every time he met somebody who had lost or tarnished the image of God in their souls, he stopped what he was doing to restore it. Sometimes it was for the rich and powerful. Most of the time, it was for the poor and powerless. Jesus didn't care who you were. He was always going to be willing to be interrupted, and that's a part of the nature of God. Hey, Lincoln, why don't you guys come on back up? I'm going to wrap this up here. As I think about Jesus, if it is true that Abraham interrupted a conversation with God to show hospitality to strangers, isn't that what Jesus did? Kind of. Abraham interrupts a conversation with God to show hospitality to strangers. Jesus interrupts communion with God to bring hope to sinners. It's the gospel. Look, our need for a restored relationship with God was a profound inconvenience for Jesus. He had spent eternities in this intimate communion with his Father. And he was willing to interrupt that in order to come to us to bring us hope. In the rest of the sermons in this series, we're going to see how God interrupted people's lives to further his cause or to bless them. But I wanted to start this way, not with God interrupting you, but with the reminder that God is willing to let you interrupt him. We need that kind of God. We need to know that God is there when we need him anytime, and that he is never going to say, not now. He's always going to say, what's up? We need him. We need that kind of God. Let's sing together.
People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, he's the open door. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. When will we realize that people need the Lord? People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, he's the open door. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. When will we realize that people need the
Hey, thanks so much for being with us again this morning. Wednesday night, we're back in Bible class with Dan Beasley and Stuart Whiting in the book of Mark. You can see a link on the website and tune into that class. And we'll be back next week. So have a great day and a great week. And may the grace, amazing grace of Jesus, bless you and give you peace. We'll see you next week.